Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Scandal of the Gospel, Preaching and the Grotesque, by Charles L. Campbell. Narrated by Rosemary Benson. I believe that closure is a steaming load of middle-class horse shite invented to pay for Shrink's jags. Detective Frank Mackey, in Tana French's Faithful Place. Forward. Heavy lifting. That's what preaching is. Those who deny this fact are lying to themselves and everyone else. Teaching preaching is the heaviest lifting in the academy. Almost everyone in the academy denies this, which means almost everyone is lying to themselves and to a watching world. If we take just the sheer volume and density of the work for a preacher, wrestling each week with difficult texts in order to offer a word from God that is bound up with and yet aimed at the cacophony of voices, the myriad of struggles, and the forest of feelings, dreams, and memories that weave together a congregation, it rushes us into exhaustion. If we take just the sheer volume and density of the work for a teacher of preaching, listening to hundreds of sermons over countless hours, reviewing the exegesis and interpretation of each one, cutting through the denials of the complexities of life, of the text, and of the preachers themselves, it pushes exhaustion toward madness. There are preaching pretenders. There are those who, when faced with the heavy lifting and the exhaustion that awaits, opt out. Like those reluctant souls who go to the gym but spend most of their time walking around talking to people, never breaking a sweat. These pretenders preach light. Easy does it. Say a few words, sound like a television commercial that glides along our waking consciousness, softly touching our attention. This will not do for hardcore instructors in preaching. They war against the pretenders, aiming to kill them in all would-be preachers. Pick up the damn weight! This is the unspoken motto of the preaching professor. There is a refined cynicism in every preaching professor I know, honed over years of listening to people avoid the weight or seek to put the weight down as quickly as possible, long before the work is done. Their cynicism is a gift from God to the disciples of Jesus, especially those who are following him at a distance, having allowed too much space between his body and their own. Charles Campbell, affectionately known as Chuck, allows no distance between Jesus' body and our own, no distance between Jesus' body and the body of the preacher, no distance between Jesus' body and the body of preaching. All of it is captured in the grotesque. Jesus is a shattering, a crumbling, a breaking, and a pulling apart of the building projects that constitute a life, a society, a religion, or even a world. Chuck knows this deeply, powerfully. This knowledge has been a signature of his writing and teaching for decades. So to turn to the grotesque was inevitable for him. What better idea captures what preaching must be in order to be of the shattering life? The idea of the grotesque in his hands is no aesthetic ploy. It is the means through which this seasoned warrior against facile preaching will teach us to see what God's overturning of the given order means for proclamation. Chuck has always been an intellectual who is honest about what he sees, never allowing the scholarly myopia that often afflicts academics to capture him. He refuses to narrow the frames of intelligibility and legibility down to disciplinary conversations and concerns in what he writes. To see the grotesque as he does in this text is to open up our negotiation with two kinds of contradiction. One, an obstacle, and the other a necessity. The obstacle is the kind of contradiction that comes from hiding from the grotesque in favor of images, ideas, and narratives that paint Hallmark movie lives of faith. Such imagined, dainty lives of faith exhibit a controlled messiness that will resolve itself into a tidy ending very shortly. In contrast, the grotto and the carnival hold truths that are closer to the heart of the gospel, where things spill out of their appropriate form. The grotesque is unleashed in the body of Jesus. Porous and leaking, his body's energies and urgencies cover everyone who comes near him, upsetting what and who and how they understood themselves to be in this world, and calling them into a new kind of experimentation of living on the edge with the Spirit and with their enemies. But how do you preach that? Wrong question. What do you understand preaching to be once you grasp the grotesque calling? Instructor Campbell wants to lead us into that calling, which brings me to the necessary kind of contradiction. The contradiction that haunts the preacher who is constantly pulled toward a respectability politic, resourced by a respectability preaching. That pull is toward a silence while speaking, and a death while living. A corpse in the pulpit, weakly sanitized so as to never give off the odor of decay. Preaching is in constant struggle against this pull toward respectability and the living death that comes once we go under this current. That pull turns preachers into propagandists for nation states, and/or plantation capitalism, and/or white supremacy, and/or patriarchy with its gender-binding normativity, and a host of other life designers working toward the pleasures of control. The pleasure of control is the source of the pull's remarkably tempting power. It moves in us in the same direction as gospel light, but without the light and without the freedom formed by that gospel. This current is a riptide, much too strong to swim against. So preachers must, like all good swimmers, allow the current to pull them out into the deep water, and then at the right moment, cut across the current, slicing into the contradiction and showing the stark difference between following gospel light or grasping for the pleasure of control, of a life, or a relationship, or a community, or a world. It is the quest for control that has brought us to the brink of our ecological apocalypse, as Chuck so powerfully articulates in this book. The necessary contradiction in preaching and teaching is to inhabit pulpits and lecterns that are captured in the politics of respectability, and yet to constantly disrupt those politics, even as one is caught up in their currents. Preaching must do this not in order to be novel or sensational or even provocative, but for the sake of the freedom that Jesus made real through his grotesque body. Meditating on the grotesque might keep preachers and preaching from losing this contradiction and then confusing gospel light for the pleasure of control. The word here is might, because taking the grotesque seriously requires cultivating a connection to those who have felt and yet feel a grotesquerie turned against their bodies and their lives, the many peoples who fail or fall outside a politics of respectability, and who could never fully actualize social uplift. Too dark, too queer, too poor, too slow, too criminalized, too unable to be able to mimic the self-sufficient white man, these folk show the body of Jesus calling us to boundary-breaking life together. Thus, the meditation on the grotesque that Chuck recommends moves preaching more deeply into the social construction of grace-filled community, places where the shattering life of Jesus forms protocols for gathering and nurturing and renaming both those who have failed and those who have succeeded at a politics of respectability. What is the new name that floats on respectability? Riding out on its currents and then turning quickly and surfing, cutting across its massive waves, claiming the overturning that marks the grotesque, and announcing a freedom with God as the source of building life together? Christian. Willie James Jennings, Hamden, Connecticut. Preface. It's come to this. I've been teaching preaching for right at 30 years, and I've arrived at the grotesque. The reason may be surprising. I've arrived at this point not because the thousands of sermons I've listened to have been grotesque. Rather, I've arrived here because the sermons have usually not taken the grotesque seriously enough. The pulpit, it seems, tends not simply to neglect the grotesque, but actively to resist it. I'm curious about that. I have done this myself, not only in my preaching, but in my writing. For many years now, I have focused on the folly of the gospel. I've spent more hours than I probably should have studying holy fools and jesters and tricksters and carnival. The whole time, the language and imagery of the grotesque have been there, taunting me, troubling me. But I've avoided the grotesque, resisted it. It seemed too shocking, too unnerving, not to mention far too huge to tackle, rearing its head as it does in virtually every area of art and life. So I just stuck with foolishness. It was less disturbing and much more fun. But the words of classical pianist Hélène Grimaud have unsettled me. In a magazine article I read a while back, she said she admired the more extreme players, people who wouldn't be afraid to play their conception to the end. I have realized that folly is not the end. Indeed, it seems to me now that folly can be a way of sanitizing the grotesque and the gospel, making them both less scandalous, more palatable. It's time to explore a more extreme homiletic. My work on foolishness was inspired by Paul's affirmation in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23, where the apostle affirms that the message of Christ crucified is both foolishness and a scandal, stumbling block. But just as I resisted the grotesque in my focus on folly, I also neglected the radical scandal of the gospel. So in these chapters, I am seeking to address aspects of the gospel that I have avoided by exploring the scandal of the gospel through the lens of the grotesque. I'm making, in Karl Barth's phrase, a provisional attempt to explore the implications for preaching of a scandalously grotesque gospel. The essays are an exercise in homiletical imagination. I'm simply trying to make some homiletical connections between preaching and the grotesque. To paraphrase from Billy Collins's well-known poem, Introduction to Poetry, I'm wandering around in the dark room of the grotesque, feeling the walls for a light switch. I'm placing my ear against the beehive of the grotesque to discover what I hear, or if I get stung. I'm dropping myself into the maze of the grotesque and trying to probe my way out, which I've discovered is actually impossible. This is what homileticians do. We wander and explore, trying to make creative connections that help us enter more fully into the impossible practice of preaching. In each of the chapters, I explore a facet of the grotesque and its implications for homiletics. I'm not seeking consistency or system, including in the intentionally diverse array of sources on which I draw. Expect tensions and even contradictions, for that is the character of the grotesque itself. In what follows, I'm simply looking this way and that to see what appears. In Chapter 1, I explore the unresolved incongruities that characterize a grotesque gospel and the implications for oversimplified homiletical patterns. I examine in Chapter 2 the weaponized grotesque, the use of the grotesque to dehumanize individuals and groups of people. I explore the calling of preachers to undertake the challenging and risky task of resisting this kind of dehumanization. Chapter 3 focuses on Mikhail Bakhtin's concept of the grotesque body and the implications for preaching in the body of Christ. Finally, in Chapter 4, I return to each of the preceding facets of the grotesque in relation to the current environmental crisis. The first three chapters are slightly revised versions of the 2018 Lyman Beecher lectures that I delivered at Yale Divinity School. Out of respect for their original context, I have tried to maintain some of the oral character of the lectures, even with the editing necessary for publication in print. I hope my journey through these lectures enlivens the imaginations and practices of preachers, and leads to more grotesque sermons. Chapter 1. Jesus in the Grotto. The Gospel as Grotesque. Blackwater is an award-winning Swedish crime novel by Kirsten Ekman. Early in the novel, one of the central characters, Annie, endures a chaotic and ultimately horrifying day. Following a lengthy train ride and grueling bus trip, Annie arrives overheated and exhausted with her 5-year-old daughter in the small village of Blackwater. She finds herself in a strange place among people she doesn't know. She's an outsider, and folks are suspicious of her. She's ill at ease from the beginning. Her lover was supposed to meet her and take her to their destination, an isolated community deep in the forest. But he never shows up, which sows its own kind of concern and confusion. So all throughout the midsummer night, she wanders lost in the shadowy forest through a maze of paths, stinging insects and tangled marshy undergrowth, always concerned about her anxious and tearful daughter. But she never finds the community. The entire experience is deeply disorienting. After hours of wandering, she suddenly comes upon a grisly murder scene. The sight makes her physically sick, and her knees buckle. As she breaks her fall, her hands land in the blood, which she instinctively wipes all over her skirt before finally washing her hands in a creek. Then she and her daughter continue wandering, lost, now under the gruesome shadow of the murder, not to mention her awareness of a killer in the area, whom she thinks she has actually seen. Her entire experience is described in excruciating detail. Even the reader becomes disoriented. Later, because she has witnessed the murder scene, Annie is taken to a home, where she is questioned by a detective in the kitchen. Ekman writes this about the interrogation. For the rest of her life, Annie was to preserve the memory of that walk. But how much of it would she have remembered if he had not forced her to describe it over and over again in that warm kitchen? There must be tangled events, illogical or utterly insane actions in all lives, to forget. They refused to allow her to forget. They forced her to bind them together into a pattern. But it was a false pattern. But it was a false pattern. This short sentence is extraordinary in a crime novel. For while good crime fiction may do many different things, crime novels are generally about discerning patterns. They're about solving mysteries and restoring some order. As novelist Steph Cha notes, crime fiction favors a return to order from chaos. Crime novels are narratives in search of some narrative resolution to the crime that has disrupted the order of things. but Ekman here ironically complicates the entire genre, not to mention her own novel. The pattern the detective demanded was inadequate to Annie's experience. It was a false pattern. So what does that mean about the solution to the murder at the end of the novel? Is that, too, a false pattern? Is that final pattern also imposed on experiences that are too complex to be captured within a neat narrative? I suspect that many preachers, myself included, frequently function as rather stereotypical crime novelists. We may tolerate disruption in our sermons for a little while, but usually we're after a resolution, a restoration of order, even if that is a word of hope far off in the distance. We seek to discern a pattern, a narrative, a doctrine that will provide some clarity and structure. One of the questions we preaching teachers often ask our students is, where is the good news in your sermon? It's an important question, but all too often it really means something like, where is the resolution? Where is the restoration of order? Indeed, entire homiletical theories have been structured around a move from problem to solution, from disorientation to reorientation, from itch to scratch. And I wonder if this model hasn't become the homiletical default setting, even for purportedly more open-ended sermons. But I also wonder how often we impose false patterns. I wonder if the gospel and life really lend themselves neatly to many of our theological and homiletical patterns. In her recent memoir about her experience with cancer, Kate Bowler challenges the false and inadequate patterns we Christians often impose on those with serious illness. She explores many of these in the book, but the title of her memoir makes the point, "Everything Happens for a Reason, and Other Lies I've Loved." That's an important reminder to preachers. Have you ever noticed, for example, how often preachers throw out the C word, cancer, whenever we need a seemingly horrible experience to address with the gospel? Just throw out the word, as if the experience of cancer were easily summed up in a single term. But as Bowler reminds us, there's no such uniform thing as cancer. Every cancer is different. Every experience is different. And it's doubtful that even caring pastors fully understand those experiences. The loved ones and the patients themselves may not even understand. Applying a general pattern to cancer from the pulpit probably results in a false pattern for most people. Poet Gregory Orr shares a similar experience. When he was 12 years old, he accidentally shot and killed his younger brother, Peter, while they were hunting. In the hours following the incident, everyone tried to comfort him by imposing a pattern on what had happened. The Christian pattern was probably the worst. "You should know that right now Peter is in heaven with Jesus," someone said. "It may not make sense now, but it's all part of God's plan." In response to those comments, Orr felt only rage and despair. "I wanted to scream at her," he wrote in his memoir. "What's wrong with you? Didn't you see his body? Don't you know what happened? Don't you know he's dead? This isn't Sunday school. My brother was just killed by a bullet and I fired it. What kind of nonsense are you saying?" And that day, Orr rejected conventional religion for the rest of his life. His mother also tried to comfort him by telling him that his father had once killed someone in a hunting accident. And here's what Orr writes, reflecting on that. "Certainly that coincidence represented some mysterious, even supernatural pattern, but who could imagine it being a happy pattern, a pattern that showed there was a God and he cared about us humans?" False patterns. That's where the grotesque comes in. for the grotesque fundamentally disrupts our familiar patterns, patterns we often use to make sense of life. As Robert Penn Warren put it, the grotesque is one of the most obvious forms art may take to pierce the veil of familiarity, to stab us up from the drowse of the accustomed, to make us aware of the perilous paradoxicality of life. Or, as Flannery O'Connor has argued, the grotesque takes us through the surface of life and pushes us toward mystery and the unexpected. It combines wild discrepancies and creates unsettling distortions in order to take us to the depths of life where our previous understanding is no longer adequate. The grotesque, to put it another way, shocks us out of our comfortable patterns, including those many of us rely on in the pulpit. And isn't that what the gospel does as well? Isn't that deep down the scandal?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.